Psychology is all around us. Psychological elements can be seen throughout the lifespan, from birth until death. Films are a wonderful tool to explain psychological theory and occurrences in our lives. Characters interact within each frame of film psychological concepts. The films we remember most and view multiple times engage us by capturing the presence of these psychological dynamics in an authentic way. I invite you to join me, Dr. Catherine Marshall Woods, licensed clinical psychologist and film consultant, and my guest today to discuss the best psychology in film. Today we have Donnie with Rue's Blues. How are you today?
I'm doing pretty good. The sun is shining, so it feels good. It feels good to be awake and alive and all the things.
Well, yes, that is lovely. And the sun is shining in LA. The sun is now shining here in DC too after a horrible thunderstorm. So we actually missed that, which is great.
Good, good.
Well, I'm so glad we have you on to talk about Rue's Blues. It is really a very unique film. Why don't you tell us a little bit about it?
Yes. Yeah, so Rue's Blues, Promise Me You'll Be There, is a film about personal development and the trials of life as you're navigating personal and intimate relationships, trying to find yourself and going through the spirals of ups and downs. The main character, Rue, is on a personal development journey after a breakup, and he ended up spiraling into a sex addiction. So we get to see how he maneuvers through that, how he relies on the support of friendship to advocate for himself, and as he's advocating for community, he's seeing himself in a lot of the rooms that he's participating in. So
again, this is a wonderful film. So why don't we show the audience a bit of a little clip, and we'll talk about it on the other side.
Perfect.
Soul searching is hard as hell.
No fucking way.
The strongest addictions are drugs and sex. Who would have thought? I ain't never did drugs or nothing, but I didn't have my share of niggas.
Bye, Titus. Enjoy the rest of your shift.
I'ma text you anyway.
Cheers to new life, new adventures, purity, growth, prosperity, and abundance as I indulge in this rich nigga juice. Spirit, reveal all bullshit and rid of everything that no longer serves me. And so it is.
Okay, so we got an opportunity to see the trailer. And this film, as you talked about, has a very rich theme and plot to it that has a lot of different factors, including the factor of a lot of education, really, for the public to be able to see. And I wonder your inspiration about sharing this education, and I specifically mean sexual education, really.
Mm-hmm. So my background is in sociology and psychology. I have a degree in those subjects with a concentration in human services. And when I graduated, I started working in the field of HIV prevention, sexual health, and mental health. And so I was participating in a lot of meetings and a lot of outreach and community engagement. And what I was observing was that the ways in which we were distributing information was not the way in which community actually receives it. And it doesn't really permeate in the way that creativity and art does. And I'm an artist, I'm a writer, I'm a creative, I'm an actor. And so as well as public health communications and consulting, I was able to somehow infuse them and make them work for each other. And so my life is like this recyclable way of absorbing information, transmuting information, and being inspired to distribute information. And so I wrote this script because I had a personal journey of my own. And as a writer and as a creative, you live life so that you can teach, you can learn, and then you teach from your experiences. And the character is heavily based off of my own personal life and how I chose to educate the community with what I learned is to really advocate for myself in that space, to release it through the form of art, but to raise my own voice in the creative space as well and make them both work for each other. So that was what inspired it.
Well, it's so interesting that you say you have a background in psychology and sociology. Obviously, we share this passion. We also share the passion of being able to communicate to the public in a way through art and how important that is, really. It's a way individuals are able to connect with what we are even thinking about in a very distant way, but also they can relate to the characters. And your characters are extraordinarily relatable. They feel like people you would know. And so I wondered if that was by design.
Yes, absolutely. Because when I am writing, I'm writing from a very authentic place. And the people and the characters that I created were actually mirrors of people in my own life. And so, you know, the relationships, the foundation of the relationships, talking about things like knowing each other since high school or going through that adolescent development journey and the things that you experience as a teen, that friendship, those friendships when you're a teenager and in high school and the relationships you have when you're in college and the relationships you make with people as you're an adult, those things have different, way differently for people. And so my character and his best friends have been friends for a very long time and they've seen each other through the development of immaturity to graduating and becoming professionals in their own ways. And also the relationships that they have, the romantic relationship that the main character is in with Levante, Ruin Levante, that relationship was built from a place of knowing what someone has gone through and how that awareness of their own trauma kind of anchors you and staying with them and sticking around. Mm-hmm. And your best friend kind of knowing that and knowing what he's going through. There's a little compassion there with the type of mistakes that the character makes or the back and forth, the tug of war. So yeah, it was definitely by design. It came out authentically or came out authentically and it came off authentically too, because those are real people. Although they are like characters that were created, anyone could see themselves in a Rue or a Mitchell or a Levante. You know, I've had people talk about Levante's situation and his story with him being born with HIV. Although he was born with HIV, and it's rare that people talk about that through that lens, there are people who are living with HIV who walked out of the theater and messaged me saying that they now see themselves differently and see themselves in space and the way that we, you know, did some eradication of stigma with this film allowed them to find some sort of peace with hope in discovering relationships and how you can be in love with someone who will care about you no matter what. So. Mm-hmm.
I have two things in my mind, and I'm going to get to both because they're both competing for a moment right now based upon what you just stated. But one of the things that I'm hearing most from you is that Rue goes through numerous different things in this span of his life. And one thing that you're really highlighting is the need for social support. And I'm also thinking about how you did that within your film. It's like you said, these long-term relationships and the relationships that he acquires more recently and that are all important, but they still have a major impact on who he is at the time.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yes, in the social support, there is a moment in the film where he was about to settle for the information that he just received and the waiting time to actually be, you know, taken care of or serviced. His friends didn't let that happen. His friends were like, no, we're going right now. We're going to get this handled. And it sucks because health equity is a very big message in this film as well, and how we are treated as Black people in the clinical space, even if Black people are working in the clinical space and what burnout looks like for them. There's so much to be said about how the movement to make change within your own life can be accelerated and by and through your friends, with them being a catalyst for change. and not allowing you to sit in a moment, or uplifting your moment and kind of like removing some of that weight, but also being like, no, you're not going to settle for this. Let's go handle this now. Or sitting on a couch with your best friend and talking about, you know, the best friend sounds like his therapist when he's asking certain questions. And that is to highlight that sometimes your healing comes from the person next to you, and they may not be a therapist or a clinical psychologist or social worker or anything like that, but they may ask questions that are similar without the same training or anything like that, but it gets you to answer your own self in a way to where that is community, and that's healing, and that is a way in which advocacy, change, and progression can take place without the resources that most people with like money or insurance might have.
That's right. I mean, you're really talking about the privilege of social support. I mean, good social support actually does provide similar healing components as a therapeutic clinical relationship. As a matter of fact, even the advocacy that you're referring to, I thought that Rue did such a phenomenal job in his way of advocating for himself regarding what he needs in a conversation when one is difficult for him. That there's a desire for a safe space to be able to have a conversation, one that doesn't have judgment. And I feel like the film does a really good job introducing individuals to how one can have a very conflictual conversation with a loved one, or not a loved one, but how to be able to get your need met and be able to have that conversation in a safe way, emotionally a safe way.
Mm-hmm. And even in the, in not just the personal space where he was challenged to have conflicting and confrontational conversations, in the professional sense where he's having to advocate for himself on the board that he sits on as, I mean, I in real life am a public health communications consultant. And so I sit in a lot of rooms on through advisory and doing insights reports and having a lot of conversations with people who operate those type of surveys or are in charge of putting together things for the community that I belong to. And so I took that part of my life and put it into him as a character, where he is, he works as a brand strategist and works in marketing and is the voice as a consultant in these type of research projects, where there are not many people at that table that look like him. And the only person that does is from a generation where they didn't vocalize as much and where their voices may not have been heard. And so that intergenerational gap between him and the other Black man that's sitting on that board, you know, he's the only one that's really listening to what Rue has to say, because these may be his feelings as well. And Rue's advocating for his community when it comes to access to resources in a way to where the people that are in charge of the questions that are being asked, or the types of, you know, surveys that go out, the format of them, it's a joke to most of them. And he does not stand for that. He's like, this is not okay. And you guys should not be texting while I'm talking. And this matters for people like me. And if we don't handle this in this meeting, or if you don't listen to me, then the decisions that you make are going to impact the prevention that affects my community. And so, yeah, the conflict and having to, you know, gain the nerve to advocate for himself, he's doing that throughout the whole film.
Yeah. Yes. Well, let us take a break. We have so much more to talk about. We'll be right back with Donahue Frazier III.
I do love what I do for a living. I never dreamed that having this career was possible until I came to UDC. I met a professor when I decided to finish up my degree program. She told me, hey, why don't you go and intern on Capitol Hill? The internship led to being a staffer. I would have never been open up to that opportunity if that professor would have never urged me and said, you know, I see something in you. My UDC experience changed my life. UDC helped me find my possible.
Find your possible. Visit udc.edu/possible to learn more.
So Today, we are here with Donahue Frazier III speaking about his feature film. We are actually going to jump right back in because there is so much more to talk about. So if you've missed anything, please go back. I mean, this is just, again, a wonderful conversation because it is such a wonderful film. Thank you again so much for joining us and making this film.
Thank you. Thank you for the platform to be able to discuss all these things.
Of course, I have so many things. Okay, so one of the things that I wanted to talk to you about is the idea of being betrayed in a relationship. Mm-hmm. And there's two sorts of betrayals that are happening in this relationship, a perceived one with mm-hmm. Rue and an actual one with Rue. And mm-hmm. I wondered your thoughts about creating these betrayals within these relationships that are really important to him, as we've talked about earlier, and how betrayal actually gets played out in these scenarios.
Mm-hmm. So what was the most important thing for me when it was like that part of the film was in my mind and how I wanted to tackle that challenge was communication and how miscommunication can have something snowball into something that it is never meant to be or supposed to be. But I also get it, and I wanted people to have compassion for both of the characters because of that misunderstanding, that sometimes if you're going through something with someone for an extended amount of time, the straw that breaks the camel's back might be too heavy for you to think like, okay, well, let's talk about this. I might just be fed up. And so, you know, the point in the film in which they separate, it's done without any type of communication or closure. There's, I gotta go, I can't do this anymore, and a disappearance. And so with that, there's a lot of unanswered questions. And so if you leave a relationship without finding out the real of what happened and you rely on he say, she say, and the miscommunication can impact the way in which you could have received healing in a different way with this person. And effective communication is a major theme between both Rue and Levante when it comes to their romantic relationship. Even the way that they discuss things with each other and the way that they process things, how they communicate that processing and how they ask for patience, or the PTSD that comes with not knowing if the person that you're talking to is going to explode or get violent or be angry. And so, yeah, the communication and effective communication and miscommunication were two very important parts of developing their relationship as characters.
One thing, Donnie, that I found really fascinating about this character in particular is how complicated and complex he was in that way. That one person can be an excellent communicator. Like, we see that. His advocacy for not just himself, but his community, how he could advocate for himself within these very challenging situations with intimate partners, even. And at the same time, this person who can communicate so well also struggles to communicate as well and has this miscommunication that leads him to all of this in the first place. Mm-hmm. And so it's so interesting to see that, you know, many times people have the idea that, oh, you're a good communicator, you should be a good communicator all the time. And I think what you're highlighting is that people are more complicated than that, actually.
Absolutely. And what impacts that, or what ignites that complication? For this specific film, it's like Rue had no problem saying whatever it was he needed to say to that board. He has no problem saying what he needs to say to his best friends. And even though it's like a little bit more challenging to say these things to his romantic partner, that took a little bit of different level of emotion out of him. And so logic and emotion are not, it's like oil and water with them in that moment between them two. And so it is different for people. And that was what I loved about the reactions that I've seen when people witness this part of the film, but witnessing it myself, is that you don't know whose side to take because they're both human. And you don't need to take a side, because I believe like you don't, in a relationship, no one has to win. People experience things differently.
That's right. That's right. I mean, also, you know, this idea that no one has to win, you don't know whose side to take, I actually think makes the film much more engageable and, again, relatable. I mean, if you have friends, which, again, you kind of see these friend circles interfacing with one another, you don't really want to take a side, nor are the characters asking of that either, which is also a mature way of being able to manage these relationships, is that no one's saying, you know, dislike this person because we're in this place right now. It's almost as if everyone is trying to facilitate conversation with each other, whether it is fighting for health regulations and health, you know, normities, or if it's actually, this is a relationship you care about, let's talk about what your feelings are right now.
Mm-hmm. And when you do talk about them, do you still have that, you know, compassion for this person that you've always had? Like, where's the softness in your heart? You know, that when you're communicating with someone and there's a misunderstanding, no matter how much they may have hurt you, depending on the level of which in which you love them, sometimes that just goes away. And it's like, it's not that big. I can still sit or lay with you and nurture your wounds, your emotional and mental wounds, no matter what it is that you have done.
Yeah. You know, I have to say, you know, even in this film, that takes work for him. You know, I'm just thinking about saging and things like that, like making sure the energy is right to be in a good place to do that, that even with this character, this is not a flawless experience for him, that too, of being able to be compassionate, being able to have the energy to be able to come in a good place also is emotional labor. Like, yeah, that doesn't just happen for people, most likely. It requires one to be able to understand what's going on for themselves, then to be able to give it to others.
100%. And when we were making the film, I remember our director of photography, Anthony Bond, he was saying, like, you know, where is the flaw with the character? He was trying to figure out what the flaws were with Rue, because in reading the script, he read Rue and Rue translated as perfect and getting everything that he wants. But I was like, that is in no way true at all. He does not get what he wants at all. It's like, he is so flawed. And, you know, one of his things was that, you know, no one's going to like this character and things like that. But I'm like, I don't need people to like Rue. I need people to see, hear, and understand him. Or anyone will find a little piece. Somebody will find a piece of who they are in him as a person, because everyone has a journey where they just want to do better, or they have a mishap and they get distracted, or they spiral and deal with different things. Everyone's vice is different. His just happened to be sex, and he would not have had that if, you know, they would have communicated, or if there was honesty involved.
You know, it's interesting. I'm so glad you brought us back to that, because that's actually where I was thinking as well, is that I'm not going to give away the film, of course, but there's an aspect of this film that I think is really an important public message regarding consent and sexuality, and sexual experiences, excuse me. In particular, in what that Rue has to kind of figure out, and people are saying to him, this is the reality of this situation. And he seems to be obviously quite aware that is what happened to him as well. And I wondered why that might have been an important message for you to offer to your audience.
One, because I wanted to educate people on what that actually is when it happens, and how to advocate for yourself in that moment, and the difference between processing that through your own cognition as between sexual assault and rape, and the ways in which we might use those different words and how they might land on someone. And without giving too much or any of that subject away in the film, with someone not applying consent to sexual experiences and taking advantage of someone, and they may not know what that might be, the way in which you inform them of what that is can either be very traumatizing or numb a person into, like, oh, well, I didn't even know that was what it was. Because Rue never really sat with it as something that deep. It was like, well, yeah, that happened. And Mitchell said that was that, but it wasn't. He was a different type of person, then that could have affected his psyche in a different way. Mm-hmm. And so I really wanted to offer this message to people, because although he was being as careful as he possibly could, and he handed the materials over, and he sat and talked about this in the meeting and all these things, sometimes you just don't know with people and you want to take their word for it. But also in that moment, who's wrong? Because there's so much being said and so much in the heat of the moment that's happening that it could come across as if it was consensual. Because when you ask someone if something feels great or whatever the case may be, and they agree, it might come off as like, oh, they like this, or this is happening. And they don't even know that might be happening. And so it was a huge message to community that accountability, one, personal responsibility, two, but also you may be being as careful as you possibly can. And it can slip, you, not that it can slip, but the other person might not be as honest as you might want them to be. So,
right. Again, I'm very thankful for that message. You know, I think it's a really difficult one to be able to communicate in a very artistic way. And I think that the way that it's done and the way that it's managed in this film is just superb.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I have one last question. I know we're about to wrap up, but do you think film and the way that film is created as an artwork, do you feel like it has the potential to heal psychologically?
Yes, I really do. Because like we were just talking about, sometimes it gives language to an experience that someone might not even be aware of. And not even just the fact that film has the opportunity to offer language or statistics or awareness or education, it offers the ability for someone to find resonance with in someone else. And in the same space, if you're watching a film with other people, you can feel the energy of the parts that land as resonating. But if you're watching something alone, you might see yourself in a character. And so all of these were like the ways in which I built this mirror of a movie was so that not only will people see themselves and feel themselves or be able to connect with a character that is created or based off of something real, it's like you don't have to go through life feeling like your experience is your own. And even if you never experience what someone in the film might experience, if you know someone who has, if you happen to experience it later, or if someone comes to you and they express to you that they have experienced something, then your ability to remember something that you witnessed through watching the film might help them navigate. And so it could be healing for the personal self. It could also offer equipment for you to be able to extend yourself as a healer to someone else. And so, yeah, I do think film has the opportunity to heal. Like,
Donnie, thank you so much for coming on Best Psychology in Film today. It's really an honor to have you on. I just can't wait for everyone to be able to see it. I will share with the audience how they can get in contact with you. Any final words?
Yes, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for offering this space and this conversation and for asking such amazing questions and for reconnecting me to the importance of this work through this conversation and how important it is to be able to see the psych and the social in this space and through film as a creator, because it really does justify the hard work that I put into it. And it also allows me to utilize my experiences, expertise, and education to really push a message. So I appreciate you seeing the psych in the film and being able to project it in this way for more people to witness.
Thank you. Well, we will see you next time on Best Psychology in Film. If you'd like to get in contact with me, follow me on Instagram at PsychMindedMedia. See you next time.